We are honored to have Professor Jürgen Handke. Okay. And Professor Don Bennett will be our guest speakers. Professor Handke is a professor in English at Philipps University of Marburg, Germany. He is one of the pioneers in digital teaching in the humanities and has been receiving many teaching awards, including the highest German teaching award, Ars Legendi Prize, okay, for digital teaching and learning in 2015. He also won the Hessian Award for Excellence in Teaching, Hessian Award for Excellence in University Teaching in 2013. And then our second speaker, Professor Bennett, is the director of the Creative Workforce Initiatives of Curtin University, Australia. Her work on enhancing employability in the arts and humanities is influential internationally and has resulted in the Vice Chancellor's Award for Inspirational Leadership in 2013. Besides our workshops today, Professor Bennett is also doing a Hersel Roadshow in different universities in her stay in Hong Kong in the next few days. For details, there's a poster near the door if you'd like to follow Professor Bennett's roadshow in Hong Kong. Both of them will share how they apply flipped classroom in their specific disciplines, language teaching and student employability. I can't wait for the sharing of the overseas practice. But before we do it, I'd like to announce the launch of our new project website. I'm sorry for one more minute delay. We have, as I said, we have a flipped classroom project with five universities. And I would like to take the opportunity now to show you our new website and also a video explaining the project. No sound.
In traditional classes, students are expected to listen to lectures during class and then do assignments to strengthen their understanding of the lectures after class. However, in a flipped class, students will be able to learn about a topic before class, usually through short and informative videos. While in class, they're expected to engage in activities with their peers and the instructor to apply the knowledge they learned and receive immediate feedback. This innovative teaching approach is regarded to have strong theoretical basis of learning enhancement. It is capable of incorporating new educational concepts such as personalized learning, peer learning, and learning through activities. The practice of flipped classroom has spread to many classrooms in the West. However, it was only recently introduced to Hong Kong and still requires further development. Therefore, as a group of teachers, researchers, and educational developers from five universities in Hong Kong, we initiated this project to provide resources and support for teachers to practice flipped classroom. Each participating university will form its own internal team to support teachers' needs according to a framework consisting of five key components. Providing resources for first exposure of knowledge before class. Creating incentives to encourage students to prepare before class. Designing mechanisms to assess students' understanding. Planning in-class activities focusing on higher-level cognitive activities. Evaluating the effectiveness of teaching approaches. In this project website, you'll be able to find constructive strategies of the five key components, vivid examples from five universities, and useful practices and advice for overseas scholars and experts. So if you are a teacher wanting to start the journey of flipping your class, this is the right place for you to find the resources you need. And please stay tuned for updates.
Okay, so this is our website now, launched right now. Thank you very much. Yes, thank you. Now, without further ado, may I invite the first speaker, Professor Hankin, and I pass the mic to him. Thank you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to my presentation about learning, teaching and learning in the digital age. You will see me walking around a lot here. Already I will show you that in a flipped classroom, or as you will see later on, in an inverted classroom, the teacher, who shouldn't call himself teacher anymore, the coach, is walking around all the time. And that's why I'm walking around and never hide behind such a thing anymore in my classes. Well, this is what I'm going to say, and you have the presentation on the web already, so I would say a little bit about the motivations and the benefits of the whole flipping program. I will look at digital teaching and learning. What is that? Many people talk about it but don't understand really what it is. I will look at the students, how they behave in these classes. We'll also say something about digital course formats, because once you have flipped your class, you apply these principles, you have a new chance to generate course formats that could have never been realized before. And also we need some prerequisites. Prerequisites on behalf of the students, on behalf of the coaches, many things that have to be adhered to for the program to work. And finally, I will say something about the future. You may have found out that we have experimented with humanoid robots recently, and I will say something about that. So that's the program. Let's start with the motivations and benefits. And in order to understand why I am using the inverted or flipped classroom model, we have to go to the back to the dim and distant past. Perhaps you remember this thing here. You won't, you probably won't. But if you laugh now, that tell me something about your age. Because that was a model, a computer model, you call it home computer, produced by a company called Commodore in the 1980s, and that was my first computer. You couldn't use a word processor on it, you had to program it. The programming language was BASIC. Before you started, you had to write a program. And then I said to myself, I teach linguistics, can't I program a grammar model which is interactive? And I did. It was a so-called transition network, you know, these circles that go up and down and that send information from one node to another. I took my computer into class, hired a big TV set, connected the whole thing in a complicated way with many cables, and played an animation for 7 seconds. 7 seconds, but the advantage was there. We could do it again and again. And that convinced me that multimedia is a key to teaching and learning, and that was 1982. And okay, 7 seconds, probably the students didn't understand it at all, I have no idea, but we played it 30 times. Of course, and I was carried away probably by the whole thing. But that was the starting point. It went on in the 1990s when we produced CD-ROMs. Does anyone know the word CD-ROM? CD perhaps, but we're throwing them away now. CDs are out. These were CD-ROMs, read-only memory, ROM, not the capital of Italy. CD-ROMs, and they were about linguistics. They were sold thousands of times in Germany, and I had the crazy idea, give the CD to the students, tell them, learn. They didn't. I was standing in the background, they were sitting at a computer, I was looking at them and nothing happened. That told me another story. We need practical material. We need material. We need to create material which really makes them do something. But we cannot simply give them the media. That won't work. So that was in the 1990s. And then the internet arrived. In the year 2000, we created now what we call the Virtual Linguistics Campus. That's our platform. You can Google that. If you want to Google now, if you want to use smartphones, go ahead. Laptops on the table, we will need them anyway. So take your phones out, take your laptops out, and Google, find these things, the Virtual Linguistics Campus. That's our e-learning platform, which now hosts 16,000 students from all over the world. We have free courses and free material. And the YouTube channel is of the same name. If you load YouTube and type in Virtual Linguistics Campus, you will straightforwardly find the big channel. That was between 2000 and 2010. And then this is our new situation. Here you see the first of our humanoid robots, and we're trying to use them in the in-class meetings of the inverted classroom. So that's my story, and let's now look at the benefit. Here are some benefits of doing all that. It's the digital world. It's the world as such. You cannot ignore the fact that students rather do this than go into a library. You cannot ignore the fact that many universities and schools have this set up. Technology in the classroom. Here is technology. Not so much, but it's sufficient for our purpose. And then this is what we need in the digital world, what our kids need to understand. They have to be competent in the digital world, not just clicking on an app on a smartphone. There's a little bit more to it. And we have to teach that. We have to implement that in the human heads, in our people's heads, on the fly. So these are some general motivations. Then there is the individualization. We saw that in the video, so I'm very grateful for that video. I will use that to really pressurize my German colleagues to do more on that end. Traditional teaching, like we do now. This is traditional teaching. It's not teaching. It's a sort of invited lecture. That's something else. But in traditional teaching, it works like this. There's a person standing at front, and you have to follow this person with one rhythm, one tempo. The materials are the same for everyone, so no individualization. But this is what we want. We want own speed, own pace, own position, own time, individual materials for everyone to help the learner in a much better way than they did in the past. So that's the individualization argument. Then we have another set of arguments which relate to the curriculum of a university. Curricular benefits. For example, you can solve curricular problems. We had a master degree program where we didn't have the staff to support three classes. So what did we do? We developed online classes. So digital help. We can strengthen in-class tuition. That was also visible in the video, that in-class tuition is a much different story now, and we will practice that maybe in a second. Extend the curriculum. We can also solve unavailability problems. The internet never sleeps. There's no holiday. There's no Corpus Christi, no 1st of May, no Easter holiday, nothing. The digital content goes on. So we can give our pupils content quantity assurance. So these are just some advantages, and here are learning specifics. And now I have to load a little bit. All these are tiny videos which show for you the benefit of using digital material just a little bit. This is, for example, a video for immigrants to Germany in Arabic. Does anyone speak Arabic? You're in the same position as I am. Let's play a little bit. And these are videos that help the refugees coming to Germany. You heard about the immigration wave in 2015. Is this off? So he is explaining in Arabic with German subtitles in a big course for Arabic refugees, the German grading system. You see German subtitles here for the Arabic learners. They learn German on the fly, and they know everything about the German grading system. Wahed is one, that's the best grade, and Hamza is six, that's the worst. Okay, we don't have to continue this. That's one advantage. You can give authentic material on the web. Then another one, which I call interactive videos. This is important, for example, for people from the German language department. Here you have a set of videos that introduce or relate the German letters of the German alphabetic system to the pronunciation. It works like this, just a quick look. And that's from our channel, German as a Foreign Language, a YouTube channel.
Oops. We need to click again.
Yeah. Okay. Otherwise, we would have waited here. So there's no spoken comment in this. You just look at the position of the letter R in the final position in the German word. Here it is. This is a word which means expert. And you see the pronunciation is A in German. And so we could give speakers of German the rule, if you see an R at the end of a word, use an A. That's all.
Vertragen.
Ignore the R.
Vertragen.
How else could you do that in 1.5 minutes? Okay. And now you can practice. Well, look at this. You've seen this, possibly, in linguistics. The visualization of speech in terms of waveform analysis, in terms of spectrographic analysis. Everyone knows that. Or here, models and modeling. Has anyone heard about the old Chomsky rule of affix hopping? Possibly not. Have you seen it? Neither. But you can make it visible here on the web. There it is. And this shows how English tense forms are generated. You select one, and then the affixes will hop. And there you are. And this is an old rule developed by Noam Chomsky in the 1957. No one has ever understood it, have made it visible. This shows quite nicely how it works. So that's one set of arguments, but there are more. Big language data. Here is our platform, languageindex.org, if you want to listen to Cantonese, to Mandarin Chinese dialects. Just click on the map, you will see speakers who produce spoken output in a systematized format, more than 800 language samples from all over the world, Jamaican, Creole, and whatever you want. So, how else could we do that? I don't have these speakers in class if I want to show an example of Jamaican Creole. There is no one around, so I use that system. And this is what it looks like. If anyone is interested in German dialects, you just select one of these dialects, compare words like book, spoken in 20 varieties, quite simple, dialectal variation. Tandem learning. Here we are into language learning. You can create tandems all over the world to learn together, or vocabulary training. All these are well-known systems which wouldn't be possible without internet, without multimedia. So these are the arguments. Now the question is, what is digital learning? Even though we have some idea about the flipped classroom, let's go back into the past. Teaching and learning consists of two things. A phase of content delivery and content acquisition, where either you are given the content or you have to do it by yourself. And then the second phase, and this is what it looked like in the past. Teacher standing here, students sitting in front of him. Well, some of them were asleep. Others were more interested in their neighbor. And some of them even read, if they could read at that time. They even read what was read in front. A duplicate of what the person did. How mad. So this was the past, the first phase, content delivery. Then a second phase followed, the deepening phase, essentially the homework phase. And this is what it looked like in the past. Students were gathering around a table. Sometimes they were controlled by someone in the back. You do your homework. Does anyone know the famous song, Another Brick in the Wall by Pink Floyd? Listen to the very end. At the very end, the teacher says something. If you don't do your homework, you won't get any pudding. So that's this sort of situation. But you have to really listen to the song to the very, very end. So this was the old situation, and then people said in the 20th century, let's change that. This is the change. Is there any change? The president of Harvard University, Shirley Tilghman, said in 2013, if you go into a modern lecture hall and you compare it with a lecture hall of 100 years ago, you won't see any difference, except PowerPoint. It's the only difference. Apart from that, nothing has changed. And so many teachers say, we have to change that. You see, the situation is still the same. They're sleeping, they're talking to one another. Some of them are even reading, so, well, not really, really, they have the tablets in front of their eyes. And many teachers disallow these things. In Germany, they often say, put them away. You can't use your smartphones and tablets in class. Well, that would be as if I had said in the 1980s, take away your watch. I don't want you to know what time it is. So this is today's situation, and now many teachers think, let's change that. They want to go digital. What are they doing? Educational technology, PowerPoint, data projector, maybe even an interactive whiteboard in class. Digitization. And in the second phase, they use PDF documents. What an innovation, PDF documents. That is, texts, it's essentially the same. 20 years ago, they were in the library. You had to get them. And you were bound to the opening hours of the library. Now the opening hours of the internet are not there. They're always available. But apart from that, there's no difference. Videos. Some teachers stand in front of a camera, let them record themselves. Hello, here we are, and put it on the web. What is the effect of that? In Germany, where we don't have, where we have a special situation, students don't come to class anymore. Why should they? Why should you travel 20 kilometers to Chinese University of Hong Kong when it's pretty hot outside and you have the same thing on the web? There's no good argument for doing that. So this is then what many people say, ah, we're digital now. But is that really digitization? It's not. It's just a cosmetic correction of the past way of teaching. And that's the standard in Germany. And now many people say, okay, we have gone digital, but nothing has changed really. And so my policy, and now we are going into the flipping classroom position, is we have to change the whole thing. We have to make content delivery fully digital. We have to use the web. Or as some of my American colleagues once said, the knowledge is no longer just in the teacher's mind, it's on the web. So why should we ignore that? Make this part digital. Well, and then, and that's the interesting thing, we have an in-class meeting afterwards. So the biggest mistake in talking about digital teaching and learning is to believe there's no in-class meeting. There is an in-class meeting, there has to be an in-class meeting. The only thing, as you can see here, look at my students, that was a photo taken from a seminar. It's completely different. There's no one standing like me in front anymore. They're working. So, an alternative could be, you make the deepening phase also digital, then you have what you could call an online class. But that's the exception in my system rather than the rule. We have a set of linguistic online courses freely available to the whole world, but that's not the courses with which we teach our students in Marburg. At Marburg University, we teach, or we have an in-class meeting. So that's the new system. And now there are several options of looking at the content integration. The first one is a simple integration. The idea is, you have a video, offer a video to your students, ask them to watch the video. This is my symbol for self-guided learning, so you have to do it yourself. And afterwards you meet in class, like this situation, maybe you use an interactive whiteboard for the keeping of the results, what you do in class, but there are other possibilities. This simple system is the flipped classroom, and here you see the literature background of those people who actually invented the flipped classroom. Wesley Baker in 2000, that was just a small paper. And then the two chemistry teachers, Aaron Sams and Jonathan Bergman in the United States from Colorado, they flipped their whole class. And in 2012, we're quite proud of that, Aaron Sams was in Marburg and told the world about the flipped classroom. So that was the starting point, really. And afterwards, they published their book. The flipped classroom. This is the flipped classroom, and it is used at school. It's a system for schools, basically for secondary schools. At primary school, the system has not been has not gone into depth yet. For university level teaching, this is too simple. You cannot expect I give you a 6-minute video and then that's economy. No chance. You need more. Also, the rhythms at university are different. At school, you have a daily rhythm of teaching and learning. At university, you often have a weekly rhythm. So you have 7 days time between two learning units. So that's another thing where we need a different, where we need different parameters at the university. And so we have to make the system more complex like this. We cannot just use a video. We also need text, literature references. We have to base our arguments on the basis of scientific websites that argue for or against a certain position. We have to add simulation and animations, maybe multimedia stuff. And the scenarios you use are not just the self-guided learning, we also integrate the social media, Facebook, WhatsApp. Our students immediately build a WhatsApp group when they come to our seminars, and they make sure that I'm not in it. And in Facebook, we have a second group where I'm also not in it, but some of my tutors. And then we have a third Facebook group unit, and I'm there, but the students won't come. So this is the situation about the social media, but they use them. And very important is this, I don't know whether you've come across about OER, Open Educational Resources. We use them from everywhere, from all over the world. We integrate what is available on the internet after a quality assurance system which we teachers apply. The in-class meeting, well, here it is. We have more than just an interactive whiteboard. Important is the smartphone symbol. We have to use our own devices. You see our students here, laptop, smartphone, laptop. They have everything on the table because we use the internet in class. We must use it, otherwise it won't work. And also the social networks. We use a lot of Google documents in class to gather data, to gather information from our students. In order to distinguish this system from the simple flip classroom, we have started in 2012 calling it inverted classroom. And that's the high school model, the university model, sorry. It was first mentioned in the year 2000 by Maureen Lake and her colleagues, also 2000, and then no one cared anymore. And in Germany, we wrote something about it in German though, that's why I'm not giving you the literature reference, and made it popular there, and that's where we won the award, by the way, about the inverted classroom. And this is the model we're using. Now, here I show you something. Now, we have many television teams that are coming to us. The television programs are in German, though. You won't understand what the commentary is, so I just switch off the sound and tell you what is on there. This, by the way, means au revoir, you know, French, au revoir frontal teaching. That was a TV program. And it was in 2015, so I switch off the sound, but you can. This is the first phase where a student is sitting in front of his computer, self-guided learning. On the basis, he writes down something in a workbook, in other books, on paper, but he sits there in front of the screen. Now he's giving a short interview to the television team, that is not important. But the main thing is, he watches videos, he reads texts, he looks at the literature. Few students go to the library, in fact, but they still do go there because we give them literature references. So that's the first phase, self-guided learning, fully self-controlled. But I will say something about that, how it works. Okay, let's stop that here, and let's now look at the second phase, the in-class phase, this phase. So that's where it becomes interesting. Now this is the in-class phase, flipped. This is what it looks like. I stand in front of that class for about 1.5 minutes at the very beginning, telling the students what they have to do. And then they have their tasks and I move into the audience. So in this setup, I have a problem because I can't get through here and help you. And I'm always in this position to be at the same level with the students. You see, in a second, or you have seen it already, I'm in the rows, I'm part of the audience, and I coach the students who do some work which we have defined for them in advance. And here I'm telling the television team that something strange happened. When you have, in the past, when you had students who didn't want to be bothered, who were badly prepared, where did they sit? The back. And where do they sit now? In the middle, because it's most difficult for me to get in there. So they've changed their approach completely. Now he tells them something again. But I hope you got a small impression. Yes.
Do you expect students working individually in that context, or do you expect them to work in groups, or?
It is, first of all, it is, that's why when I came in here this morning, it was so silent. The inverted classroom in class phase is loud. It's definitely loud. It's physically exhausting for me because I walk around all the time and the students want to contact me. Some of them say, no, no, leave me alone. But most of them say, can you help me? Or here I have a question. And I go around from that position right over there and do that 20 times in 90 minutes. So we are on the run all the time now, we're coaching. But that's the system of the inverted classroom as it works. And I teach on the basis of this system in all my classes.
So how do you find out the different progress from individuals? I mean,
we will come back to it.
Individually or as a
group.
How, does it bother you or is it a concern how fast they move, if not how slow,
Everyone has their own speed, and if I see some student can't solve a certain task, I ask them whether they want my help, or they ask me for applying my help. It's totally individualized. And there are students who are ready after 20 minutes. Then, when Paul asks me that question, what do you do then? I always have reserve tasks, pulling them out of my back and saying, here you are. Here are another 10 words to analyze. Here's language data from Maori. Look at that. And so on. Here are two examples, language teaching. So this would be the self-guided phase, for example, received pronunciation, the British dialect for German learners. You would define a foundation, a simple contrast, give it typology, the content. And in class, this is the setup. I'm sitting here, there are the students, that was a screenshot from the video you've just seen. And we do practical error correction, training, remedial action, but nothing about the theory. And if a student asks me, can you tell me what an allophone is? What would your answer be? I would tell you, take out your phone and Google it. I'll be back in 2 minutes. That's it, because you do it all the time. And then we look at what you found. You found probably something from Wikipedia, and I would say, forget it. But this is what students do, and I want them to do that. Sometimes we have Google tasks for them which totally distract them from what they should find because they simply type in the simplest term and take the first entry from the Google result. And we have a list of such garden path, I would say, terms that lead you up the garden path. So this is an example. Here's another one, linguistics. The evolution of language, that was the unit you've just seen in the video. Theory, foundation, simple theories in the content, in the digital content. And in class, what did they do? They created a language that could have been spoken by Neanderthal, Homo Neanderthalensis. Completely theoretical language, where you have to apply phonetics, phonology, where you have to use word structure, language typology. So the whole bag full of linguistic knowledge applied in class. And they were writing down that the sound system of that language had to create 10 words. Something which was impossible in the past to do that. They could have never done it. Maybe as a homework, but then I would have had to correct all that stuff. So that was impossible. How do the students react? We're coming to the students now. There's one problem which you might have asked yourself about already, namely, how do I make sure that they master the digital content? Because this phase only makes sense if that has fully been grasped. Otherwise, you can't do it in class meeting. In order to answer the question, I want to integrate the system which you have here, namely the U-Reply system. This is my reminder that we now want to go into a question. Okay? You know the system? Paul told it to told about the on where are we? So this is what you have to do. There's your number. All right. Current response is zero. Do I have to start it somehow? It's already started, but it still says there. There. Okay, first response has arrived. One deductive principle when you do this, what I call live voting, is that you shut your mouth as a teacher. Because in the past we have these clicker systems, and then you have to read out the question. Do you want to stop? 23. I'll wait until 30. Okay, I stopped the whole thing, and there we see the answer. So what did it, and the question, so B is the majority, and so I have to click on question. B. Optional, you are absolutely right. In German, in Germany, in-class meeting is optional. And that gives us an enormous problem. How to, can I attract students to come to my in-class meeting? Here it is obligatory, you have to come. But in German, the law says you cannot do this with people over 18. It's against the German federal law.
Oh.
Yeah, well, this is over 18. You are free to decide what you want to do, even if you're involved in education. So this is, of course, something which we always have to bear in mind. You have to make our in-class meeting as attractive as possible. And I told you earlier on that in augmented digitization system, where they use PDF documents and that stuff, they go down to 20% these days. But they don't tell anyone. So this is only unofficially known. That in-class attendance has gone down, has dropped to 20%. And that's amazing. So I will show you figures in a second. What do we do in order to make sure that this content has been mastered and that students come to that phase? That's the question. This is what the flipped classroom does. Appealing, hoping that students do it. That hasn't worked for the past 500 years. If you tell students, read that by next Tuesday, 5% will read it because they know the teacher will repeat it anyway. So people don't do that. Obligatory in class attendance. That's something which we, and in fact, you know, Germany is a federal system. One of our states, North Rhine-Westphalia, they think about reintroducing obligatory in-class attendance, but there are demonstrations at the moment. The students don't want that. That's a capitulation if you reintroduce obligatory in-class attendance. You could apply additional tasks before the in-class phase, but that would mean that the teacher has to do more work, because you have to correct it between these phases. So there's only one escape, namely this. In-class questions, you've just seen that. I've just asked you a question, and since you know that in Germany obligatory in-class, that we have optional in-class attendance, the majority knows this, I know you have a good understanding already. And I asked three of such questions at the very beginning of my class, content questions, with a similar system we have in Germany. And you know systems like Kahoot, YouReply, we have Pingo and Ars Nova. There are many systems around, you can use any of those. In-class questions, and then the most important one are mastery tests, electronic tests which operate here. Electronic assessment about knowledge, nothing more than knowledge. I will show you such tests in a second. And you could combine that with bonus systems. Students like to have badges. I'm the emperor, I'm the king, I'm the master, I have a high score of 99.8%, and yours is only 97%. Ah, I'm better. So students like that. So this is what we do. We use all these three systems in order to make sure that the content has been grasped after the digital phase. And I can tell everyone in the whole world, this is the most complicated system in the inverted classroom. And there are many people who try the inverted classroom, but they don't have electronic assessment, and then I can tell them it will never work. This is really a lesson we learned. We've been doing this since 2009 and have gradually developed these tests into more and more professional systems. Okay, so this is what it looks like now. Content delivery is a complex system which also has integrated tests. Tests where students can try out without being controlled in a sort of game-like fashion, drag and drop tasks and tasks where you point at something. Multiple choice is also among them. That's these integrated tests. Then we have the mastery tests. They're called formative tests because they tell me how I have to organize the in-class meeting. They form the in-class meetings, and there the students have to show mastery in terms of what they know or what they don't know. It's knowledge tests. Well, and then in class I do the live voting, which we've just seen. That's the three bars, the three big things about testing in the inverted classroom. We call this model inverted classroom mastery model, and the principle, bring your own device, that is, bring your stuff with you, applies in all phases. You need your computers, your phones. Tablets are used, but they're not so dominant. Our students in many polls which we have conducted have told us, I have a smartphone and a laptop. Either I use the phone for quick tasks or I need a real keyboard. That's why tablets are a little bit, well, overrated, I would say, in terms of teaching and learning. I see some of you have tablets, but it's not wrong. But for government, I told my government, don't invest money in big tablet programs. Okay, that's the model. And here are the components as they look like. This is the digital content. This is what it looks like. It's basically websites in our virtual linguistics campus. You can register there for free, and then you can do courses in phonetics, in semantics, in morphology for free, and you will see exactly that. It's always the same structure. You see, it's text, first of all. Then the text is linked to a video. If you click here, you are directly linked to our YouTube channel where you see the electronic lecture of something like 10 minutes about the same topic, the classification of languages here. Here you get to download the notes, the slides, or whatever was used in the videos. Then we have the interactive tutor you have just seen, that's this link, the integrated testing. We have the whole system in terms of e-books, which means you can use it on your phones even without internet access. So you can learn at any time, anywhere. We have guiding questions. In each unit we have 10, not more than 10 guiding questions. And this is really very important for the students. They know if I can answer these 10 questions, I've mastered the content. So it's a recommendation to do that. Guiding questions, which are linked, as you can see here, they're linked into internal information or even into videos. So that's the system of online learning on the virtual linguistics campus. And this is the testing. This is one of the mastery tests, the electronic tests. These tests, as it says here, they test knowledge. So it's really about learning, and learning by heart and knowledge. So we deliberately say that because it's so different from the in-class phase. Knowledge. These are the test formats, single choice, multiple choice, dynamic choice, and input tasks. Meanwhile, we have wiped out single and multiple choice because my policy has always been multiple choice in a subject like linguistics or language learning has never been a test format. But I had to use it in order to start with the electronic assessment. So meanwhile, we've changed it to what we call dynamic choice. Here you see such a system. You see a question, type of secondary articulation is, and then you only see one option first without seeing the other, and then you have to decide on the spot, is it the right one or not. Here it was right to say it's not glottalization, so you get the next option without seeing the two more which are going to come. So you don't know, is that a good one or not? And this test is, it works fantastic. And it works even more fantastic because our students said we hate that test. And that was the biggest support for us to implement these tests. So we are really capitalizing on dynamic choice now. We developed that format, so if you use it, you can refer to me as the inventor if you wish. I programmed it myself in its program, first in Flash, now it's in HTML, JavaScript combination. But we programmed that ourselves and it works. And this is what the students see. They see their test results of previous tests. You see this was 2016. relatively regular, 17, 19, 26, 26, 6, November, 9th, November. They had to do two tests within a week. These are the results. The student score, high score was 100% in each case. So this student currently has 29%. For me as a teacher, the important thing is that I get a percentage level of all students before the in-class meeting. And that is what we call the mastery level. The mastery level, the knowledge level based on these test formats before the in-class meeting. And this is the in-class meeting. Here you see screenshots or photos of the in-class meeting. And you see there's no teacher, nowhere. Sometimes it's even hard to find a teacher. Here, this is one of my tutors. She is the coach. She helps the students. Unfortunately, we have this architecture. The architecture is not the architecture we need anymore. We need new architectures. I've seen a photo of Hong Kong University, where you, Chinese University, where you already have such rooms, which use the so-called tulip or rose architectures named after flowers. If you want to find out more about architectures, remember the following name. It's a British guy from London University, and you will remember that name because it's Diogo and then Casanova. Casanova, that's his name. Diogo Casanova. Just Google for him and you find architecture suggestions about classroom architectures. Casanova. You know the Italian guy Casanova? You better not. Okay, Google Casanova. Not Diogo, but Casanova. Then you find what kind of what guy he was. So this is the in-class meeting. What do we do there? Not knowledge. Knowledge has been done after the digital phase. Competences. We train competences with our students. So they will analyze, they will sort, they will segment what linguists have to do. Data, 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 data. And we don't tell them what an allophone is, what a morph is, how to find a subject of a sentence. We don't tell them in class anymore. They have to do it and they know it in advance. And this is how students behave. Now here you have some results. This is where it becomes interesting. This was a class in winter term 2016-17 from October to February in Germany. We had 91 students in the introductory course Linguistics Informatics. It was a 4-hour class. 4 hours on the trot, starting at 8 o'clock in the morning in the German winter. You know what that means. Okay. Probably you don't, but you can imagine. I left Frankfurt on Friday lunchtime at 10 degrees below zero. With gloves. So, the red line are the online accesses for the unit that is in focus. Let's say tomorrow we're talking about evolution of language, then, and this was the unit, then 94% of the students were in that digital unit. What they did in there, I can't tell you. I mean, you know all the system, you load Amazon, you load it and go to the toilet. So this counts. We don't know what they're doing, but they were in that unit. And you see the average, just in time, online accesses, of around 78%. I'll tell you something about the valleys in a second. The mastery level, that is, the tests just before that unit, hover around 64%. See here we have almost 80, then we have 38 once. I'll tell you why this is so in a second. And then in class attendance, which is optional, they don't have to come. Almost 70%, which is a good value in the German system. And that means 91 students we had, 69 were coming, that's 63 students, and if you relate that to the mastery level, 4 of them were unprepared. So I had on average 63 students sitting there, and 59 were prepared. And then you can straight go into it, and the 4 who were unprepared could easily be identified, and they even admitted and said, okay, last night I saw Champions League Real Madrid against Barcelona. So, sorry. That's, you can, and you can help them. Why do we have these low values at some places? Well, this is interesting. Local bus drivers were on strike. So the students couldn't get into the in-class meeting, and since they knew that in advance, they procrastinated, as you would say. They pushed it away for a moment, and the values dropped down. Here, I was in Berlin. So I couldn't, I was not available, and they knew that in advance. We didn't tell them, but they found out. The values dropped to the bottom. In other words, we have to tell them the in-class meeting takes place. Even being unfair, if you know it doesn't take place, as a coach, tell them it takes place and inform them an hour before. That would be a little bit nasty, but a day before. So, and this was our reading week where all classes were cancelled except mine. And so I forced them into the in-class meeting, but they didn't really care. I mean, okay, what is it, the yellow one? They still were there, but preparation was a little bit different. Okay, so that's how students react. And this is how students react when they continue their degree programs, because the more they do it, the more likely is the acceptance of this model. And you see values go up. This was a class in the first semester. This is an advanced course where students are in their fifth or sixth semester. And then they have understood the system. They know, I better come. I better do the mastery worksheets. So values go up. Okay, digital course formats. What formats do we have? First of all, we have, this is the model, we have courses that involve an in-class meeting. So, digital component beforehand, in-class meeting. The standard inverted classroom. And now we can generate interesting course formats from these, from this model. One is the two-in-one model, and the other one is the so-called flock model. And I don't think you have any idea what I have in mind. So I'll show you the flock model, which is really an amazing derivation of the whole thing. This is a semester, 15 weeks. In a classical teaching and learning scenarios, you would have one unit per week. The German semester lasts 15 weeks. So this is traditional, one unit per week, every Thursday from 8 to 12 or whatever. Now you digitize that. We get away of that guy and digitize the whole thing. Now it's digital. Why the hell should we stick to the weekly rhythm? So couldn't we tell the students, well, you can do one unit every 5 days, not every 7 days, or even one unit every 3 days, every 2 days, every day, every hour. It would be a little bit hard. So we decided for these 3 days and introduced that to our students 2 years ago. My colleagues didn't understand that. They said, why the hell are you doing that? Isn't that an administration effort, additional organizational complication? I said, yes. What can the students gain? Can you see that already? We're doing an exam at the end. What can you do if you do a 5 days rhythm? You can move the exam earlier in the semester, and you don't have to write all the exams of all your classes in the same week at the end. So this is what we did. And in fact, this was a class which had exactly 99 students, and 70% chose which rhythm? 5 days, definitely. 5 days was the key. 10 chose the 3 days rhythm. They could have done the class online anyway. They were the best. They wanted to get rid of that class as quickly as possible. And then these were also 10, roughly, that chose that traditional rhythm. There's one complication, though. We have an in-class meeting, and the in-class meeting is still every Thursday. So, here is the in-class meeting. Week 3, for example. This is the in-class meeting. The first cohort was in week 3. The second was in week 4. The third cohort was in week 6 already of the class. What did that mean for me? I put the students into their cohorts, said there is the 5 days, there is the 7 days, there are 3 days of them. They have different practical material. And the only thing I have to do is concentrate. Concentrate on what they're doing, help them in accordance to where they are in the course. For me, it's complicated, not for the students. And there's also one thing which is quite interesting, which you don't see at first sight. After week 10, but no, after week seven, we have already got rid of that cohort. They're doing their exam. Out, they're not coming anymore. And after week 11, or at week 11 onwards, we only have 10 students in that class. What an individual training that is for the 7 days with students. It's amazing. We call it FLOC, flexible on campus course with car in German, with K in German, but I think FLOC has also meaning they're organizing flocks, really. That's why we left the word FLOC, flexibility on campus, flexible on campus course. And this system works. It works fantastic, and students like it. They now ask me, can't you do it with every course you teach? So for me, it's a little bit complicated, especially these weeks here. This is the complicated period, week 3 to 6. It's amazingly complicated, but that's all. Then it becomes very simple. There was a question.
Examination.
Yeah.
Students take examination. So does it mean that the examination questions are different for the different batches, or are they the same question?
They all write the same exam. It's an electronic exam at the computer, a competence training exam. And the questions are drawn from a database which contains hundreds of questions, and they're drawn at random. So every student gets a different exam anyway. So it doesn't matter whether they come in February, in January, or in December. Electronic exam. And they're weighed the questions, they have certain values, and so we're absolutely sure they get an individual exam which is of the same complexity as your neighbor's exam.
The mode of examination is pretty much on the concept, but as a language, what about the oral, the communication part?
Well, that's done in class. We communicate with our students, but that doesn't go into the grade of that class. So we don't grade in-class activities. But that's the German study degree program system, the modular descriptions. So this is the FLOC system, it works. The two-in-one concept is very simple, by the way. It's a concept where you do the following. In our system, we have two introduction to linguistics classes, one for BA students and one for teacher students. They're slightly different in terms of content. There are linguists in the audience. Are there linguists in the audience? Or don't you want to give away that secret? Well, there's a difference in terms of, you know, we have 15 weeks. The difference in terms of 5 units. A teacher degree, the students need different input as compared with BA students who might want to go on a master degree program. So what, ideally, you would have 2 classes. German universities don't have the staff to teach 2 classes. So what do? All students in one class, same content for all, which is of course not in accordance with the degree programs. And that's done at every university, but no one talks about it because they don't like talking about it. So what do? We design 2 classes with different digital content, and then in class we put them together and place them into cohorts. Teachers over there, BA students over there, give them different or individualized training material, and that's it. That's the whole story, 2-in-1. Theoretically, you could give 2 completely different courses in one. So one course in semantics and one in phonetics is a little bit complicated for one person. I wouldn't like doing that, but here I have 5 sessions that are different, and that's it. The rest is identical. So we put up plates. It doesn't say reserved then, it says BA or teacher. And then they know where to sit. Okay, so that's the first type of courses, and then we have, of course, the possibility of designing online courses. SPOOC, the specialized on-campus online course. That's online courses for students who can't make it, who are in your degree program but can't make it. Pregnancy, studying abroad, illness, or even, which is often the case, if you study 2 subjects, timetable provision. And then you are allowed to do that class online. You don't have to come here. You get a sheet which tells you are allowed to do it online, which means for us, we have to assist the students here. We cannot leave them alone. It doesn't work. An online course alone doesn't work. You have to do something in this part. And this is, in our case, intensive tutoring via Skype, web conferencing, and emails, and even social networks. So we have tutors who assist the students in the online component. Otherwise, they fail. No chance doing a class just online. But then we also have MOOCs, the big online courses. You saw some of them, which was fit for the German university system for Arabic immigrants to Germany. You saw just that one video. Let's look at these. So here are the online courses. Everything is digital now. These are our two MOOCs, DOI for Arab, German pronunciation training for Arabic immigrants, and fit for the German university system. They were run via a German platform on campus. If you Google that, you will find the platform. It hosts something like 100 massive open online courses. But you know platforms like Future Learning England, Coursera, edX, Udacity. You know them all, I hope. So here's a German one, because this was German oriented. It's in Arabic, in English, and German, these courses. Even won a price. And then we have the permanent MOOCs. So that had 3,600 participants. And our permanent MOOCs on the Virtual Linguistics Campus, meanwhile, over 5,300. We have 6 permanent MOOCs where the digital phase is almost identical to what we do with our students in class. But we have made sure that here we have some sort of automatic guidance. In the normal MOOCs, which you know from Coursera, Udacity, or elsewhere, there's no deepening. There's no one telling you what to do. There's no one helping you. This is my explanation why these MOOCs never get more than 10% finishers. Because you don't have a deepening phase there. It's missing. So in this system, in our MOOCs, we have the deepening via Facebook. It works, but not really well. About 40 to 50% of the students are in the Facebook group. They help each other, but the effect is relatively meager. So we decided to do a little bit more. We decided to create a sort of FAQ, frequently answered question, video-based system, where the system knows at what point what question could be asked. And then the video pops up and explains, hopefully, the right thing. And we have in our permanent MOOCs, where you define the beginning and the end and your own rhythm, everything is fully automatic. In our MOOCs, in these permanent MOOCs, we have something like 32% finishers. And that's quite a reasonable result. I would like to have more, but we permanently get the news, automatic news. Some people from Korea have finished and have just downloaded their certificates, but we don't do anything. You can register for these PMOOCs on the Virtual Linguistics Campus for free. You can do whatever you want. Speech science, words and word structure, the nature of meaning, the structure of English is a class, history of English, and language and linguistics. That's the 6 classes we offer. Free. So that's the online classes. And all are based on the same principle of like the inverted classroom. Digital teaching learning first. Mastery worksheets, you all have all the mastery worksheets in these books, and then a deepening phase based on practical questions. Okay, so much for the courses, now the prerequisites. What do we have to do in order to make our students to accept the system? That's really the biggest job we have to do. Well, this is the system, you know. We have now an idea about the system. First thing is, bring your own device is a must on all levels. Computers. You need your computers wherever you are. Whether you're on the metro in Hong Kong, whether you're sitting at a table, whether you're at home, you work with digital devices. And in the end, we're writing an electronic test. This is a shot from our computer pool where students write the electronic test. So we have computers in all phases. By the way, we're the only ones, I think, maybe even in the whole world, who allow internet access during electronic tests. We had to redesign the questions though. So we're not asking for knowledge anymore. You could Google that. So we have completely new competence training questions evaluated by the computer. That was a big thing. But now students can use the internet. They're not allowed to use their smartphones because for equality of chances, some of you have a wonderful iPhone and others have an old Nokia thingy. So you have to use a second tab in your browser in order to use the internet. So they have two tabs open and then they do their electronic exam. And about 10% of the time we found out they use for internet search. They also have websites available beforehand which they want to consult in order to solve their problems. But that's what we do every day. So why should I switch it off during exams? It's silly. So that's bring your own device, the computer on all levels, even in the final exams. Second, self-guided learning is a must. And that's where most students fail. They come to us in their first semester from school where they were not allowed to use their smartphones. In German schools, you're not allowed to use your smartphones. This is a big thing, and it's one of the most silly things I can think of. So you have to give it away when you enter school. And what do pupils do? They go over the wall, outside in the street, and leave. So, you have to learn self-guided learning, because you can't do it. Maybe I heard about, did we talk about it, Paul? Chinese students, the attitude of Chinese students here in Hong Kong, that they're possibly also a little bit resistant to doing that self-guided learning. You have to organize everything yourself. Well, what do you have to do? Individual pace, individual time, individual place where you learn. Individual materials and choice of scenarios. Do you use Facebook? Do you network with the fellow students? What do you really do and what do you want to do? You have to take these decisions. Do I do it at any time or do I have a timetable where I say every Tuesday afternoon I do linguistics? We found out that students now start doing that. That they organize their fixed timetables in terms of electronic access. So this is what you have to do here really. Smartphone, book, computer, you have to organize it yourself. Well, this is what students do now. This is the latest class, winter term 17-18, the just-in-time accesses. That is self-learning, the access to the digital units. And you see the average has now increased to 77%. It was 73% in the other term. 4% more. Our students, we can now tell, have mastered self-guided learning. And then there's something interesting. When do you start learning for your exams? At the end of a class. What do our students do? Activities go down towards the end. In other words, they have done it all. They have mastered it all. And that's a curve about which I'm very happy. Because we don't have this start of the term, starting here, going down, and then in the end it goes up. That's a classical teaching scenario. But for us, it goes down. Well, at the mastery tests, you see it's almost the same line, a little bit lower. That means not everyone who accesses the digital unit does the test in time. At the end of the class, the mastery level is 100%, because they can do all tests in retrospect, in advance, at any time. But this is just the just-in-time mastery test, and it's almost the same, a little bit down. Why it is a little bit up here, I don't know. We have to look at the particular test. But it's virtually the same. So we can now conclude our students have mastered this. And I'll tell you what they've done in a second. The exam was passed by 74%, and 63% of all the students passed since they had more than 77% of just-in-time access. 51% passed, they had more than this level. That is, if you have more, if you're higher, you definitely pass that class. So we can now inform our students, tell them, if you come to the in-class meeting, if you do the mastery worksheets, you will pass the final exam. And that's what happened. And I can also tell them, if you don't do it, don't come to the final exam, you will fail. This is a clear-cut conclusion. Next prerequisite, in-class attendance can be made optional. Yes, it can. Students come to our in-class meetings. What do we do there? assistance, support, information, research, training, competence training, and so on. This is what it looks like. You've seen these pictures before. And this is the curve again. Attendance is now 70% almost, a little bit higher than previously. 61% passed since they have more than these 69%. Again, the same conclusion. And now, okay, the students come voluntarily. We don't have to check whether they come or not, they just come. Digital education promotes social contacts. Now, this is something which you often hear, that when you go digital, they are all in isolation. The students don't talk to one another anymore. They don't talk on the metro when they look at their smartphones. Did they talk in the past? Did you say hello when you entered the metro to anyone who was standing there? Possibly not. It was the same 20 years ago. We looked at a newspaper, or we were there silent. But now you have your smartphone. It's the same. We have a different device in our hands. But many people claim that. They say social contacts don't exist as soon as you go digital. Now we asked our students. Attendance here, the figure is in this class 76%. Now, this is we often use the Google poll system in order to ask anonymous questions. For time and again, we do that in our classes. And here I ask the students, what about student-to-student collaboration on a particular task? Let's say you're talking about minimal pairs, they have to do a task. Do you talk to your neighbor then? Here you see the result. 55% did always. They always talk to one another. Student-to-student collaboration, they work together, sorry. Here they communicate. Talking is even more, which explains to you that it's loud in an inverted classroom, in class space. And then, the result about which I'm most proud is this one here, because there's no violent, no never bar. In other words, of these 85 students during the semester, everyone talked to me at least once. And that's impossible in a traditional class. There are students who remain silent and I will never have exchanged a word with them. So there is permanent communication, permanent collaboration, permanent social contacts, and we know from the students that they build learning groups. In the corridor, they're sitting together doing the digital task. So digital education promotes social contacts. Well, here is a summary of these felicity conditions, which I might want to call them. Self-guided learning. You must implement a system that enables your student for self-guided learning. Can anyone check the Google folder, which I gave you? Is there the Inverted Classroom Manifesto in it, which is a 2.5-page publication? It is, okay? What we send around at the beginning of term to our students so that they know why we are doing all that. The Inverted Classroom Manifesto. Then, at the beginning of term, I also send around an email once more which tells them, listen, you have to bring your phones, you have to bring your laptops there. Amazed about that. And I tell them what to do before the first in-class meeting, very precisely. Mastery tests, as I said, e-assessment, without it, forget the system. You have to have a test in between. And in-class attendance, well, I said it's optional, this is the organization. I have not talked about architectures here, but we need different architectures. I hope I demonstrated that to you, that it would be impossible to talk to you with this sort of architecture. And then something which is bring your own device, always forget that. And then something for the preparation, here it is. Inverted Classroom Manifesto and Welcome Mail. We have a unit in our courses which is called the class preliminaries. There's no content in it, just videos that give you advice on how to study online, what to do at a work at a certain time. So these are not, this could be done for any subject. Exam statistics, I always tell my students, now here are the exam statistics of last term. Students who didn't attend in class meetings failed. Well, that's a sort of warning at the very beginning, but it has to be. And then what I call formative self-assessment, and here I have an example of formative self-assessment. Again, it's a Google poll. 3 times per term, I ask my students, how competent do you feel in and then the identification of vowels, the identification of consonants in the analysis of minimal pairs, in the analysis of phonemic structure, construction of syllables, identification of transcription errors. All these are linguistic competences, and they have to answer this question. And if the blue bar is very high, I don't train that anymore. But if the orange bar is very high, then we have a formative effect. So transcription errors was the focus of the next in-class meeting. Phonemes, well, a little bit, but we did not use consonants anymore because everyone felt confident in consonants. And if I look at the final exam, it was so. It was exactly like that. They felt confident and they did that themselves. So it's a self-assessment and it forms, it's formative, it builds my strategies for the in-class meeting. So this is the new thing which we implemented last term. So much for the inverted classroom. Now a little bit about the future. I leave 10 minutes for questions if you wish.
Okay.
All right, the future. Here you see, these are our robots. We have 4 robots, 2 for training, 2 for in-class use. And the whole project is called HEART, Humanoid Emotional Assistant Robots in Teaching. And it's financed by the German government. And we are trying to find out, is it possible now to use robots and where? So the idea is quite simple. This is our teaching and learning system. You saw all these things, inverted classroom mastery model, 2-in-1 flock system, MOOCs and all that stuff. We have now gone mobile with our platform. I hope Moodle will soon be available on a smartphone. So students use their smartphones for the platform. They can do everything from anywhere. E-exams plus internet, I told you all about it. We have tested collaborative electronic exams where we built groups. It worked, but it was very complicated from the administration point of view. We had one test, we will do it again. So when part of the exam will be a collaborative group organized exam. Because we think in the modern world you work in groups and not in isolation. So everything worked and we asked ourselves in 2017 what is next. And then everyone was talking about artificial intelligence. But where can we use artificial intelligence in such a system? There are 2 options. Software solutions, for example, chatbots, pedagogical agents that remind you of doing something. When you're lazy or when you switch on your phone, you see something, hey, what did you do last Tuesday? We were going to do linguistics. So a chatbot coming up, avatars, things like that. Or assistance robotics in education, where you use robots in class. So that's the 2 options. We were talking about these options a long time ago already, namely in the 1980s. That's where it was when I started and I published even about that part of artificial intelligence, and namely intelligent tutorial systems. They were built in the 1980s, and everyone who was involved in software engineering was talking about at least one point intelligent tutoring, building a learner model from the data you receive and then drawing conclusions in order to individualize teaching and learning. So we could do that in the 2 phases where we have software, intelligent tutoring. Today, of course, we want to generate money from our governments. We do the same thing, but we use different terms, big data. But it's the same thing. We use the data from the platform in order to generate models of our students, and do I have to repeat myself? No. So this is what we're doing already to some extent. So it's nothing new. But this could be a real innovation. Robots only in the in-class phase. And it only works in the inverted classroom. It doesn't work in a traditional lecture. Imagine there would have been a robot next to me who would have talked to you 50 minutes. And some of you fell asleep after 5 minutes of my talk. A robot, I cannot guarantee you, it lasts 1 minute and then you're asleep. So it doesn't work. It only works in such a scenario. That's why you need a digital scenario. How does it work? This is what we do in the scenario. Assistant, support, information, discussion, and so on, see it all here. And this is what it looks like. Humans. There's a coach, there's a coach, there's a coach, and that's me as a coach. So the question which we ask ourselves, couldn't we use a robot in such a position? Especially for those things that are automatic, that are simple, that humans don't want to do, wouldn't that be possible? Well, here is our robot. Now, this was when the German television was there, it was in October, that was a world premiere, a robot taking over a class. It's in German, I can't, I just run the movie. The robot talks English at the very beginning, so I leave the sound open for a while and then switch it off, because it will be German. Okay. So this was, imagine the following situation. First-term students who had never been allowed to use a smartphone in class, who expected me, they didn't know anything about it, and then a robot came from behind a curtain. The first word was the robot, not me. First-term students, nothing about the digital experience. This is what it looks like. John, I start again. I start again because he speaks English at the very beginning.
Hello. Darf ich um
auf den Kalt
denken?
Es geht jetzt los. Aber sofort nur noch auf Englisch.
Mein
Name
ist Pepper. Zum ersten Mal war das ein Roboter, die
man schon. You see what he was highly interested in. The girl was frightened. In fact, she failed the exam. she never turned up regularly. This is what the robot does. I showed you the application in a second. He generates a quiz automatically from our platform, controls everything about that quiz. The students solve the task, and I, at the beginning, I activated the robot by looking at him, and now I'm part of the audience. And while the quiz questions are running, I can help the students. That's the game. The quiz was running for 4 minutes, first term students, and the question was, one question, how many vowels does the English language have? Students who have never heard anything about linguistics. And you know there are 20 vowels in English, but everyone thinks there are five, and then it's worthwhile discussing what about the why. No one could Google, because the internet doesn't tell you. The internet says either five, six, well, there can be phonology, orthography. And the robot was helping them. In the meantime, he was saying, think about the following, and he was giving hints. And then the next question came up. It was, I think, the question, how many meanings does the sentence John saw the man on the mountain with a telescope have? And again, students who had never heard anything about it, so 10 minutes was the robot. These are other robot applications for language teaching. ELTutor is a project from the European Union where we use these now robots. For language tutors at primary schools, vocabulary training maybe, geographical tutor is also a NOW model. These models come from the Japanese-French company SoftBank Robotics. You can buy them. Everyone can buy them these days. The only thing is you have to program them. This is NOW, who asks students for engagement if they don't do anything. It detects students in their movement and tells them now please what is going on. And this is our Pepper model. We have used him as a vocabulary trainer. He has the advantage that he has a tablet and can make things visible as well. So you can make things visible especially we train that with our Arabic immigrants learning German vocabulary because he can pronounce German correctly. We don't have to do it anymore. So these are new ways of using robots, humanoid robots, but that's a completely different story, and I could give you now 2 hours talk about humanoid robots, which I don't want to. It's a very exciting new area. We don't know where it ends. I have no idea whether it will work in the long run, but we have to try. And this is what I can recommend to all of you with the inverted classroom. Try it. Go ahead. You have the possibility here in Hong Kong, which we don't have in Germany, because our teachers are resistant through their whole body. They don't want to change, they don't want to give up traditional teaching, they have it all in their backs, the old PowerPoint slides, or even overhead transparencies. They don't want to give up that resistance. You have wonderful technology here. You have the options, and you will soon already have taken the lead over countries like Germany. So thanks for your attention. I hope I could give you some.
Inspiring talk. And we now have time for a couple of questions. Is there any?
Yeah. Yes, thanks very much. It was wonderful, very, very useful. So just on a cultural comparison, so I spent 12 years in Germany, mostly in Frankfurt, and then have been teaching here for 10 years. The last 3 years in the law faculty, I've been teaching flipped. Mm-hmm. So it's been over a 3 year period, about 550 students. And culturally, I mean, you mentioned that you were discussing with Paul, you know, so the sort of cultural attitude. One aspect is the students come out of the secondary school looking for passive reception of information only. And then we have evaluations of teaching, which essentially ask the student, have you been given information in a way that you have to exercise the least effort? Right? That's essentially what we asked them. Like, was this as smooth and painless as possible for you, you know, the least effort? And if you, I found that when I was teaching something, say beginning a topic where I didn't know it very well, or teaching in a different faculty where I don't have high expectations of the students becoming lawyers, these evaluations are perfect because you're not pushing the students. But, and also in law, when you simply give them information, they're not doing very well. They will fail the test, but they'll give you the evaluation before they take the test. And so they like it. But when you ask them every week to see what they don't know and to struggle to learn something better, they scream out of these evaluations painfully. They say, you know, get rid of this person, fire this person, get rid of this course. I mean, really, they use obscenity sometimes in evaluation. So I mean, in terms of culture, we've got these two elements. I mean, you mentioned Hong Kong, we've got technology, we've got a lot of positive aspects. Germany definitely has a very strong tradition of what the teacher should be.
Yeah, and in Germany, we only discuss the risks and dangers first,
right,
before you do anything. Like here, you do something, and then you discuss the risks.
But we've got, when students are asked, have you had to use energy? And then they can nix the course, they can eliminate the course because they use energy. What do you do then? Have you had to face something like that?
Well, first of all, you're aiming at workload aspects, I think.
Well, also in class, because if you showed the students in what the second slide, the students sleeping in class.
Yeah.
If that's their aim, is to sleep in class.
I have no problems with that.
Then if you make them actually work through practical problems in class, they can't sleep.
Yeah. Okay, first of all, they can't do that, but I often observe students when they administer their Facebook account in class. I have no problems with that, as long as they do the tasks.
Right.
And the speed of doing the task differs enormously. There are students arriving, we have practical sheets which are online with model solutions after the in-class meeting. Some students have done all these practical questions in advance, wonderfully laid out on a piece of paper with text markers and everything. Others have done nothing. So it's a totally different thing, but I have to keep them engaged all. And then what I've also tried, and it works not too well, engage those students who are ready to help the others.
Sure.
So peer education. But in Germany, envy and resistance is a big topic among human beings in general. We are resistant to all these things. I always keep saying, when Google Street View drove through the German streets, what did the Germans do? They hide. They hid. They hid, and afterwards they put their house into pixels. What did they do elsewhere? They asked Google, what shall I wear in order to look nice on a photo. So this is the German resistance is always there when you do something like that. You have to be very careful. But they're on different levels. And so, as I said, I always have tasks in my pocket, which I hand out. And when students are ready, and I can see they've done it all, go home and leave the room. Well, why should I keep them there? That's one thing I do. Then they can go. Yeah, you would appreciate that, wouldn't you? Then you work perhaps harder and do everything. But if I see that they can't do a certain task, then from time to time I have to explain something in the sense of, listen. In fact, there are new technology, by the way. I walk around, you saw that maybe with the tablet. And with the tablet, I control my laptop. And I need that if I'm at that end of the room, and if I say, listen, I have to show something on my laptop with a pen, then I don't want to walk there. So I have to be prepared for these situations somehow.
Can I ask one quick follow-up question? Have you seen anyone that has designed immersive games? I think that's the only way that I could get the students to expend the energy and actually get good evaluations.
I think I have seen that, yes. But even then,
because it would essentially be a test, right? So you'd have a test that you put characters into the test for performing the different aspects of the students being tested. And then if the characters were engaging, then they wouldn't notice if they were using energy.
No, I haven't done that yet. But from the experience now, we've used this model since 2006. We failed a lot of times. Mm. And I can only encourage you. You have to be prepared for that fail.
Sure.
Tell your colleagues in advance that you want to do it, because they will laugh at you when you fail, because especially if they're resistant towards digital teaching and learning. And I think in 1996, the local press wrote about me in my hometown, computer will replace professor. That has been my stigma for 20 years. And there has not a single professor been replaced by a computer, at least not up to now. I don't know about the situation of robots, but that's a different story, maybe not in our lifetime. But you have to be prepared for that. The first failure we had in 2006 was that we simply repeated in class the online content. And students said, why the hell are you doing something which is there already? We did it. Next term, we didn't repeat, but we did something else on top of it. They said, that's too much. In all the other classes with the colleagues, we don't have that. We are now doubling our efforts. And so over the years, we have then gradually reached a balance, which was very difficult to reach. But now we have the electronic material, practical sheets. You can see them all on the Virtual English Campus. Thousands of model solutions, data analysis. The Virtual English Campus has more than half a million websites internally. It's a huge system just for one subject. Just for one subject. And it takes time. Yes?
Hi. Thanks for the talk again. I really enjoyed it. I've also been fully flipping my classes for the last 3 years. I'm now at a point where I think it's really great. It's doing well. But in terms of... So you talked about peer learning and it not being very effective. That's actually one of the things that really makes the class, I think, special in my particular case. And it seems like an interesting combination of like market-based economy incentives, like, you know, points for interacting and, you know, group-based exercises, and only if the whole group does well do they get points. So there's that, market-based economy. And on the other hand, sort of community norms, inculcating, oh, you really should be helping each other, these are your friends, these are peers. And there's a tension between them that seems like it's really quite important to make the whole system work.
Yeah.
Communism, social, and capitalism sort of hand in hand. I wonder if you have any like such philosophical thoughts about what drives your classroom design.
Well, you probably remember the diagram I showed about the social contacts. I didn't say that peer learning is not effective. I only said that, well, we use peer learning, but I haven't evaluated that, the effect of it. It occurs all the time. Students collaborate as long as they can. I mean, in a system like this, only three students can collaborate effectively, 1, 2, 3, because this person cannot talk to that one. So we have to cope with the system we have at the moment. I'm longing for new architectures, and in the one photo you saw where we had the table, We are just like furniture removers. We have to do it every week, putting up these collaborative table setups. And immediately after me, a colleague who teaches literature comes and rearranges it to the U form again. And so next week after, we have to rearrange it for us as well. So collaborative learning works. It is done. I can't tell you any effect. And this is a general problem. You will often be asked, now is the flipped classroom, is the inverted classroom more effective than traditional teaching and learning? You will never be able to tell. Because how shall you compare it? You have a different teacher, you have different parameters. You cannot compare two classes. Different students, different teachers, different setup, there's no way. All you can do is what I said at the very beginning, these benefits that we have. Individualization, new course formats, and so on and so forth.
Yes, it's a good presentation. So I just want to know. The flip course is better than the traditional course. So is there any compare that you have done to compare your class with the traditional part of for example, linguistic?
As I said, this is hardly possible. How shall I do it? I did it 3 years ago. I, as a teacher, gave two classes, same topic. One was in the inverted classroom format, the other was traditional. You know what happened? The students complained, those in the traditional course complained, why don't we have the digital material the other side? And then I had to give it up after 3 weeks, and I also was emotionally more involved in the digital model, so possibly my appearance was worse in the traditional class. So this is impossible to evaluate. All we can say, the advantages I've mentioned in the very first three or four transparencies, that's the advantage. And then there's one advantage which came through, well, almost through the back door. It's we are admitting that the world has changed in the 21st century. That's for me is the most important thing. I cannot ignore that students walk around with digital devices these days. But that was central in the 20th century when we didn't have these things. That's why I think this is what we have to do.
Thanks for the question and thank you, Professor Hanke again. May I now have our project co-leader, Professor Kevin Chen, Research Assistant Professor from the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, to present souvenir to Professor Hanke on behalf of the Defense Organizers League.
Looking for the next 5 minutes. Three.